1/3 of women who are suffering from gynecological conditions also report suffering from psychological conditions. Ayurveda always say, unhealthy mind give rise to an unhealthy body. In short, emotionally suffocated mind starts vomiting body illnesses. Now the question is, does this also relates with PCOS? I mean, can stress cause PCOS? How is this possible? Question mark. Stress is in the brain and PCOS in the ovaries, that is reproductive system. So don't stress your brains. Let's check and also other factors causing PCOS. So watch the video till the end. Hello and welcome to Trupt Wellness. This is Dr. Trupti and today we are in the second episode of PCOS. In earlier episode, we have already discussed about what is PCOS, what are its signs and symptoms, how to assess whether I have PCOS or not, that is Rotterdam criteria, and also what are the changes going on in the body when you are suffering from PCOS. In this episode, we are going to talk about causative factors and what is the view of Ayurveda on PCOS along with its complications. Now coming to the cause of PCOS. So modern science says that the cause of PCOS is unknown. Means we can't blame any one specific thing to cause this condition because we know that this is a syndrome, means it is a group of signs and symptoms. At the same time, this science says that PCOS is a multifactorial disorder. So from this we can conclude that there are number of factors responsible to cause PCOS. Now Ayurveda also says the same thing. It describes PCOS as an equal involvement of doshas, dhatus and upadhatus, means different factors are involved in it, right? Ayurveda doesn't describe about PCOS directly, but we can correlate it with yoni vyapad. Yoni vyapad are nothing but anatomical and physiological disorders of a reproductive system in women. Now let's list up the causative factors. Acharya Charaka says, Mithyacharena tastrinam pradushtenartavenacha jayante bija doshascha daivaccha shrunuta pruthak. So here the first causative factor is mithya acharan, which is nothing but inactive lifestyle. As the technology is gearing up, society is reaching unnatural level of sickness. Everything is controlled by AI, artificial intelligence nowadays, just on a click of button, right? So this is turning the lives of people more sedentary. Also, very less physical activities are involved nowadays because we are just sitting and working on the laptops. So your body starts depositing fat as we are not using glucose in any physical activity, which is eventually stored as a fat in adipose tissue. Now what does this adipose tissue do, or how is it responsible to cause PCOS? Let's see. For this, we need to understand that in normal ovaries, a process called aromatization occurs. Now this is nothing but conversion of androgen into estrogen hormone. Estrogen is the hormone which is responsible to bring out the menses. Now in PCOS patients, this aromatization is not occurring properly in ovaries, which means there is defective aromatization. And instead of ovaries, it starts happening in the fat, that is adipose tissue, which is called as peripheral aromatization. Now what happens due to this? Now whenever this conversion happens in ovary, it releases a potent estrogen, which is estradiol. And whenever it happens in periphery, that is fat or adipose tissue, it releases estrone, which is a less potent estrogen. Now this estrone is responsible for increasing LH again and reduced FSH levels. Now if the FSH levels are low, there is no maturity of follicle. If the follicle is not dominant, then it will not be released out, means there is an ovulation. Now you might have understood that the more you become inactive, more is the fat deposition. More fat depositions means peripheral aromatization. which leads to anovulation, that is no menses, which is the characteristic feature of PCOS. Now the second one is dosha dushti. Here the word dosha is addressed for both sharirik and mansik doshas. First let's talk about mansik doshas. So these are nothing but rajo and tamo guna according to Ayurveda. We can also correlate this directly with stress in modern science. Now let's see how stress impacts ovarian hormones. Whenever you are in stress, your adrenal gland starts making and releasing cortisol. Adrenal glands are those small glands present on top of your kidneys, which are also called as stress glands. Now this cortisol is very important for your bodies in stressful conditions to overcome that stress. Now what it does is, it allows your body to send more and more blood to your brain and more glucose to your muscles so that your body can act faster to come out of that stressful condition. Now this hormone is very good only in temporary condition, but when your stress continues and is for longer times, then the amount of cortisol is also increased. And you know what? Adrenal gland needs some raw material to produce cortisol, and it borrows this from progesterone. Yes, you heard it right. It borrows this from progesterone, means your body is sacrificing production of progesterone to make cortisol, because it finds that is more important in stress. And this is possible because progesterone and cortisol are made from the same mother hormone, pregnenolone. And naturally, when one child is in danger or facing exams, mother will give more attention to that, so pregnenolone produces more cortisol and it decreases the production of progesterone hormones. Now this progesterone has the capacity to lower down the rapid secretion of GnRH and LH, which is the main problem in PCOS, which we have already studied in detail in first episode. Also, the ratio of estrogen and progesterone is disturbed, which is again reason for longer cycles, which is the characteristic feature of PCOS patients. Stress always keeps your mind confused, and it's said that confused mind always brings confused cycles, means irregular cycle, that is nothing but PCOS. The next factor is dushti of sharirik doshas, which are nothing but vata, pitta and kapha, and this happens due to mithya ahar, which can be directly correlated with improper and unhealthy diet habits. Now how diet impacts your brain or secretion of hormones? Let's check. There is a communication system between our gut, that is intestines, and brain, which is called as gut-brain axis. Now this system is also called as ENS, that is enteric nervous system, which has the control over endocrine functions and immunity of our bodies. Actually the intestines are connected to brain by a nerve called vagus nerve. We all know that our brains and CNS, that is central nervous system, consist of trillions of neurons which direct our body functions daily. But surprisingly, you must also know that your intestines consist of 500 million neurons which are connected to your brain. Yes, and the gut cells and also the cells in the digestive tract has the capacity to produce neurotransmitters. The neurotransmitters are nothing but the one which has control on your emotions, moods, hormonal secretions and all those things. You might be knowing about the hormone serotonin. Yes, the one which is necessary for good sleep, and also it makes us feel happy. Now this hormone is also called as feel-good hormone or a natural antidepressant. But the fact is, it is produced 90% by your gut, that is your intestine, and only 10% by your brain. So now you can imagine that how important your diet is and how it has the impact on your hormonal secretion and endocrine functions. For example, if you eat high fiber foods like whole grains, nuts, seeds, fruits, It contains prebiotic fibers, and prebiotic can reduce human stress hormones at a great extent. Now, I hope you'll recall all these things whenever you fill your system with pizzas, burgers, and all those junk foods. The next factor is Bija dosha, which can be directly correlated with genetic factors. It means this syndrome is present in the women from birth itself, but it manifests at different stages of life whenever it finds the favorable atmosphere to express. In some girls, it is expressed at the time of puberty itself, while in some women, it is expressed after marriage, and we diagnose it as when they find difficulty or failure in conception. So now from all this discussion, we can come to a conclusion that what we eat, what we do, and what we think are the three main basic things responsible for the cascade of PCOS, right? So this was all for today. We hope this information will help you. Don't forget to share the videos with the needy ones. In next episode, we will discuss about complications and treatment for PCOS. Till then, stay happy, stay blessed. Thank you.